10 things I saw from Raptors Bulls November 7th. The defeated Moore Lowry, more wins. Kyle Lowry asked for more touches and he delivered. The offense flowed a lot more through Lowry's hands and everything clicked. He was able to push the pace, score easy transition buckets, and most importantly, Lowry was able to set the table for others. He found Serge Ibaka and Jonas Valanciunas for so many easy opportunities after navigating through the high screen. Raptors take another step forward with win over Bulls. Sportsnet.ca. Probably the best you can say is that the Raptors, their starters in particular, chose not to overlook Chicago and instead seemed determined to put their collective no-show against the Washington Wizards behind them. The Raptors entered the game Tuesday night ranked 23rd in plus-minus in the first quarter this season, compared to 7th overall. A year ago, Toronto was 16th in plus-minus in the first quarter compared with 5th for the entire game. It's a bad habit because if you go ahead and dig yourself a hole, it's hard to dig out in this league. It's very difficult, said Raptors head coach Dwayne Casey before the game. So it's mental. I don't think it's anything to do with physical or warm-ups or anything like that. It's something that traditionally we've done, which is a bad habit. It's very difficult to put your finger on it, but it's coming out of the locker room ready to go and not waiting until you get punched in the mouth to start competing and getting a lather going and that type of thing, he said. Again, it's a phenomenon. You can make numbers say whatever you want them to say, but it's all about coming out and competing in the first quarter. The numbers weren't all that impressive early against Chicago. Toronto led 2,926 after 12 minutes, but the effort was notable. Raptors almost blow it, hang on to beat Bulls 119,114. Raptors HQ. All of the good was washed away as the Bulls made the game far more interesting than it ought to have been. You could play off Chicago's slight narrowing of the deficit early in the fourth to good old-fashioned garbage time complacency by Toronto. The second unit was in, and not screwing up in any sort of cataclysmic way. Bobby Portis, playing in his first game since rearranging Nikola Mirotic's face, just kind of started to heat up. At first, it seemed benign. But as the Raptors' offense got stickier thanks in large part to DeRozan, and Portis added to his 14-point total in the frame, the comeback effort felt more threatening. Casey's move to reinsert the starters midway through the quarter exacerbated the problem. If there is a silver lining to the hairy finish, it's that more fuel was added to the Ibaka and Valanciunas can't play important minutes together discourse. Casey picked up on the front court's incoherence after a couple minutes, slotting Pascal Siakam in for Valanciunas, ending his otherwise solid 21-10 night. And then came the near meltdown from DeRozan. With the score 115,109 with just 71 seconds to go, Chris Dunn picked DeRozan's pocket. His reaction to the perceived non-call likely would have seen him tossed if Sunday's ref crew was on the job at the ACC once again. Had he been issued a technical foul for slamming the ball down in the airspace of the official, maybe we're talking about a completed Bulls comeback. Ultimately, the Raptors' shot makers bailed them out. But at WASNT exactly a moment of jubilation, when a DeRozan turnaround jumper all but sealed it at 117,112. It was more a half-hearted punch than a dagger to Chicago's gut. Raptors barely finish what they start so well against Bulls Toronto star. It's probably not sustainable for the long term since there really aren't enough minutes to go around and keep everyone in the flow of the game, but Casey used 12 of his available players before the game was 14 minutes old and used 7 subs over the course of the second half as well. Having strength in numbers may sound good, but not knowing which 4 or 5 of the 7 will be best each night can be frustrating. You have no choice, the coach said. We've got some guys who are playing equally, nobody's really stepped up above anybody else. There's going to come a time when we narrow it down, but right now, got to see what we've got. The backups were good but far from great, and it was most a substitute-laden group that allowed the Bulls to get on an early fourth-quarter roll. The young group did a great job and then they lost some of their steam and momentum scoring-wise, and that's when we put the other guys back in, Casey said. I thought they did a fabulous job in the first half getting the lead, and then we started faltering there in the second stint when they weren't there. Raptors hang on after Bulls nearly erased 23-point lead Toronto Sun. The irony is that the Raptors' big issue coming into the game was slow starts. But on this night, it was the slow finish that almost cost them. But don't be overly fooled by this one. The Raptors had this one well in hand, and the final score was as much a testament to human nature as it was any indicator of how close these two teams might be. I think we kinda just got comfortable playing with a lead, Norm Powell said after the game. That's one of the toughest things to do in the league is continue to have your foot down when you're beating a team like that. Just continue going thinking it's oh, that it's a close game, just trying to close it out. we've got to do a better job of coming out with the same sense of urgency we had in the first half. In short, the Raptors did what they needed to do and very little more. I categorized this game tonight as a win is a win, Kyle Lowry said. It wasn't how we wanted to close it out, but a win is a win, the offense is getting better, we are just continuing to grow and we will continue to get better at it. Bulls vs. Raptors final score. Bulls can't dig out a first half hole in another lost blog. A bull, the fourth was mostly garbage time to start, and that's where Bobby Portis eats, baby. I mean, he was active, and Fred Hoiberg left him out there a while, ultimately 24 minutes overall and finishing with 21 points on 13 shot attempts. He also had 13 rebounds and 4 assists. Seriously, it was a bit weird seeing him out there getting praised for hard work while the team was down big and frequently getting beat on defense, though actually that's not weird, it's Bulls culture. But while there were fits of the effort lapsing in this game, to their credit the Bulls did climb back into it. They played with lineups with Portis and Markkanen at the 45, Denzel Valentine shot well, and the team kept chipping at it. The Raptors' lead did get down to 6 with around 5 minutes left, and down to a single possession in under a minute. But they never got totally there. DeMar DeRozan, who a possession earlier saw his pocket picked in the backcourt by Dunn, one of Dunn's 4 steals, made enough plays down the stretch. Fact or fiction, the Raptors through 10 games. The Athletic subscription, the Raptors starting unit is going to need to change. Fact, in 71 minutes heading into Tuesday's game, the Raptors starting lineup, which had only been healthy for 5 of 9 games, was leaking 7.6 points per 100 possessions. A stronger effort against the Bulls cut that down, but the problem remains defensively. They are now letting up 111 points per 100 possessions through 10 games. Coming into the season, the only question was whether Powell or Miles would start on the wing. So far, that question seems far less important than what is going on up front. Serge Ibaka struggled next to traditional centers in Orlando last year, and struggled next to Jonas Valanciunas in Toronto after the trade. That trend has continued so far this year, and the Raptors are swimming in options to change their look. Either Poole TL or Lucas Nogueira could step in for Valanciunas, or Siakam or Anunoby could step in for either, potentially creating a smaller, quicker starting lineup. The starters had some nice moments against the woebegotten Bulls, helping turn a nice lead into a blowout in the second quarter, before the whole team conspired to fritter most of the lead away in the second half. Increasingly, Ari is finding a connection with both Valanciunas and Ibaka. Questions linger on the other end. Siakam replaced Valanciunas late in the game on Tuesday as the Bulls put a significant dent into what was once a 23-point Raptors lead. Don't expect the change quickly, as the Raptors are doing just fine on the whole. However, if and when a change comes, it could be awkward. Neither Valanciunas nor Ibaka has come off the bench often. He got thrown out for me. Raptors Fred VanVleet has mentor in Kyle Lowry. The Athletic subscription, it's palpable how much Lowry's example has meant to VanVleet early on in his career. Even if he jokes that he didn't appreciate Lowry putting pressure on him in the preseason by saying VanVleet is ahead of where Lowry was at this same time. Given how Lowry's demonstrative style can sometimes look, and considering some of the reports that came out during his free agency this past summer, Lowry being such an important mentor to a young player may come as a minor surprise. VanVleet bristles at the idea. Yeah, it's definitely bullshit, man, VanVleet said. He's a great leader for us. He's not your typical leader, he's not your diplomat where they're trying to appease everyone. He's not the guy that the media wants to make up into this great guy. His teammates love playing with him. Well, guess what, everybody didn't love playing with Kobe Bryant. But that shit won 5 rings. There's no guidebook to being a leader. There's certain qualities and traits that you have to have. He has them. Lowry very likely couldn't care less what the perception of his leadership is outside of the locker room, though he's been clear that improving as a leader is a goal. Inside of it, Lowry is more lead by example than cheerleader, working tirelessly, taking young players to a hot Pilates class, or coordinating dinner on the road. In VanVleet, he sees a kindred spirit, someone who entered the league with some of the same knocks against his game and a lot of the same chip Lowry wore on his shoulder because of it. Raptors 905 have to start all over again. Toronto star few basketball executives will be wired quite the way Tolzman is, as a matter of fact. He built a D-League team that last year posted one of the best seasons in league history, won the first championship under the Maple Leaf Sports and Entertainment umbrella and, poof, just like that, it's gone. When the 905s open the home portion of their regular season at Mississauga's Hershey Center tonight against the Long Island Nets, only one player, guard Negus Webster-Chen, will be back from the group Jerry Stackhouse coached to the title last June. 7'3 center Eddie Tavares would have been the second, but he signed with Real Madrid on the eve of the 905 opener. Others have moved on to higher-paying jobs in Europe or the NBA or to other G League teams. The league changed titles after last season. It's the price of doing minor league basketball business. Why did Kari Hilson and Serge Ibaka break up lipstick alley lol? According to some fonts here, he got a girl wifey back home. Kari knew and was still trying to muscle her way into the number one spot. Other fonts that knew him said he never serious about her, or three, he was probably out hoxing and she had enough this time, shrug, probably for the better, wanting Serge to keep his deck to himself is selfish, bih. Did I miss something? Send me any Raptors-related article video to rapsfan@raptorsrepublic.com.